Hello everybody, welcome back to Totally Creative. I'm Grace and today we're going to be revisiting my old watercolors. I want to start off by showing you guys a swatch card and doing a little test. This is a test to see how much binder to pigment ratio there is, and you take a paper towel and rub it on a dried piece of paper that has the paint on it, and if pigment comes off like it did here, that means that there's not enough binder. That binder is usually replaced by filler. Filler makes these paints chalky, and that's one of the biggest complaints about these paints. I wanted to talk about that first because that's one of the big things everyone talks about when they talk about these specific cake pans. What I'm going ahead and doing is mixing up a nice blue for my background. I have put some masking fluid down so that I have a nice crisp outline of the piece that I'm painting. I start off with some blue and I fade it down to a light brown slash yellow. They don't have any colors or pigment information, so I can't say for sure what any of these colors are, but I can assume and guess what they are according to my knowledge of the watercolor colors. So what's going on now is I'm letting it dry and then I'm going to go and peel off the masking fluid. I ran into a little problem here when I peeled it off. It took some paper with it, but it ended up looking like cool texture, so that is just all behind me. What I'm doing now is taking some light brown and going over where the log is, or branch. I am just lightly sketching out where I want the branch to be with some dark brown. I had to take my pencil and draw out where the feet would be because if I didn't, I know I would go over them and then this bird would just be feetless and that would just look a little weird. So I sketched that out and now I know to go around it. This is a simple picture of a bird. The reason I chose this is because it's really beautiful, easy to follow along, and because it shows the colors of the palette well. As you see, I'm laying down some deep purple, some orange, yellow, greens, reds, pinks, and lots of blue. Since there's so many colors on this bird, I thought that it'd be great for this palette because it displays all 36 of the colors. What I'm doing right now is laying down my base colors by little zigzaggy lines, dots, and sharp ovals to look like the feathers on the bird's wing that you see me doing right now. It's like an oval with two sharp edges on either side to create one feather. And I'm doing multiple of those to create the wing there. The reason I'm doing sharper and more distinct feathers on the wing is because they look different from the belly of the bird, which is the majority. So I wanted the feathers on the wing to stick out more. The tail, I'm just doing a dark navy blue with some cobalt blue on the side where the wing extends, and I'm mixing up a orangish red to go over a second layer on that purple. The reason I'm doing multiple layers here is because I wanted to build up contrast, and layering helps add shadows and depth to a painting. The next thing that I'm going to be doing is mixing a green and a little bit of a light blue to make a teal color. They didn't have a teal, so I had to make do and mix it sort of on the page and in the palette. It came with a little mixing tray, but I lost that a long time ago. What I'm doing now is adding some darker tones to the parts that need some shadows because there are a lot of shadows in this picture. I didn't want to have too many dark spots because this picture is very bright and airy. These paints were my elementary paints. I got them when I was about 9, and you can get them on Amazon for about $7.50-ish. You can buy a couple different brands, but they're all basically the same. Some come with a couple brushes, but I advise buying brushes separately because you don't know the quality of them. These paints really started me off in watercolor and gave me a passion. Even though they're not the best, they are great to start off with, and I do recommend them to children or beginners. What I'm doing right now is going through and adding another layer of blue and brown along with some purple. I'm adding these layers upon layers to give contrast to the picture and to give it a realistic slash full look. The next thing I'm doing is taking a brown and doing zigzags, swirls, polka dots, and lines on the branch to make it look realistic and organic. Okay guys, I'm going to transition from the painting to the paint. I want to talk a little bit about the behaviors of this paint. There's three big aspects. The first one is opaqueness, the second one is line strokes, and the third one is chalkiness. The first one is transparency. Watercolor is known for transparency because you use lots of water to lighten it, which brings the see-through look and effect. And when you have paints like this, which have so much filler, you lose that and it just looks opaque. The next thing I want to talk about is strokes. Here's an example of a stroke on a dark brown part of the swatch. You can see there's a zigzag motion where the paint was laid down and it didn't dry evenly. This happens when there's a lot of filler and the paint doesn't settle evenly, so it just goes where the brush strokes were. And in professional or even student grade paints, your paint will glide across the page and not create these borders. That's something that you have to invest in nicer watercolor paints to get rid of. The third thing I want to talk about is chalkiness. These paints specifically are known for their chalkiness. Professional watercolorists and people in the art community know these as the cake watercolors, the cakey chalky pans. You know, they're these dry, brittle, spongy watercolors, and that's not a desired feel. One of the things you do for professional student grade watercolors is you spray them before you use them to moisten them. You can't do that for these because they soak them in and dry them up, which is a little bit annoying. And the chalkiness comes from the filler. The filler makes this paint mixture uneven and replaces the binder that should be there. This is part of the little experiment I showed in the very beginning of this video to show and demonstrate what I mean by chalkiness. All right, back to the painting. What I'm doing here is adding some splashes and paint splatters onto my painting to give it a little bit of pop. This is something I enjoy doing when the painting feels too flat. You can add these little polka dots to lift the painting and give it a more realistic but fun and creative vibe. The next thing that I'm going to be doing is taking a jelly roll pen and adding in some highlights. Now I took some white gouache on a small number 2 paintbrush and added little fuzzy feathers and tiny details that I couldn't achieve with the pen. I wanted to add some flowy highlights as well, and it looks more natural when you're using a paintbrush. Thank you. I'm peeling off the last bit of tape, I feel the satisfaction of a finished piece. This palette worked wonderfully for me today, and although some of the downfalls of having a cheap palette kind of got in my way, it turned out to be just the way I wanted it. I hope that the information I provided helped you guys, and I hope you enjoyed this video. Until next time, bye!